what you're saying about the Asian church. But I am so excited. I'm really excited about two things. I'm excited about how good the Asian church is doing. And I'm excited about the fact that Brother, Pastor, Bishop, and Sister Young are in the Rock Church. Now, I'm not necessarily glad for Oakland that they're not there, although God has given Oakland good leadership with Brother, Sister Caputo. But I am glad they're here. Amen. This is a good example of what a dramatic difference it's going to make that Brother Young is here, like he's already working with Asia Rock, and we're going to see progress in areas that we have not seen here before because of their anointed ministry. So I'm just praying God continue to give him strength and continue to be a great blessing to the kingdom of God. Amen. Before you're seated tonight, let me read a scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. This is not unfamiliar to you, but it is such an important scripture. When I'm writing doctrinal material, I find myself using this scripture over and over and over, but there's so many applications to it. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 13, it says, For by one Spirit... By one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free. That meant whether you're slaves or free people, and have been made to drink into one Spirit. And for a few minutes tonight, I want to talk to you about our connectedness. Our connectedness. Now let's read that verse one more time. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. I want to talk about our connectedness in Jesus' name. Everybody said in Jesus' name. God bless you. You may be seated. Amen. So I hope you've had a good day today. We're going to wrap it up with a good night tonight. Amen. And I don't know what you may have done today at work, but it's been, if you did what we're supposed to do, you attended to the kind of work you needed to take care of your family, to take care of yourself, to take care of the work of God. I started this morning with going and looking at a new facility that Wilson University is moving into that's bigger and better by far than where we are. And much less expensive per square foot, and getting it all lined up. Brother Ryan Babineau, who's not here tonight, but who is, I think, still in Roatan, actually helped us connect with these people and got this beautiful place. The purpose, the main thing, instead of the process. Purpose is the main thing, not the process. And make the process bow at the feet of the purpose instead of the purpose bowing at the feet of the process. So, and Sister Jennifer and others worked on that today, and many other things going on that God is just helping us to do. And so here we are tonight. I am excited to be in God's house. It feels so good to be in God's house. Amen. It feels so good to be with God's people and to talk to us a little while about our connectedness, our connectedness. And a few weeks back, I had a student who wrote and talked about it. He said he had listened to the lecture for that week, and he said there are several things outlined in the lectures this week that require close inspection, and he said they have really profound implications when you talk about them and think about them for a little while. And then he proceeded to articulate what he had learned that week, that there is an obvious connectivity that exists in the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. And there is, the more you read the Bible, the more you see how many ways, even though it had a number of authors and was written over a period of 3,500 years, the amazing, the unspeakably incredible way that Scripture takes us on a journey of human history. And as I've often said, the Bible is the only book written in the world that gives meaning to human history. Other books record it, talk about it, and so forth, but the Bible is the only book that gives meaning to human history. And it shows, if anything shows, it shows that between every generation that there is a hook, a link to the next ensuing group that is coming along, and that all the way through the book, the people of God have this connectivity that is continuing. It is an interdependency. So here I am preaching tonight, and I'm utterly dependent while I'm preaching upon men that preceded me by 2,000 years and wrote this book, and by things that they did. And you and I are utterly dependent upon these people. So the concept of independence, when it is taken too far, which doesn't take long to get to that point, becomes a whole false premise because of the necessity of our connectivity to people that we have never met. And then, of course, there is the spiritual connectivity that we'll talk about a little bit, and often have mentioned in times past. But the Bible tells us in Psalm 145 and verse 4 that one generation shall praise the works, thy works, to another, and shall declare thy mighty acts. One generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts. So maybe it's not just an accident tonight that the young people, many of them are at Camp West this evening, and that you and I are here. I told the pre-service folks, I said, I'm going to preach a message to old people tonight. And some of them said, well, that would exclude us. I said, well, you just have to listen. You just have to listen to us old folks. But in reality, there is no generation gap in the kingdom of God. Somebody says, well, I want a young person to preach to the young people. And that certainly is necessary. However, when everybody gets in the Holy Ghost, it doesn't matter if they're young or old. It matters if they're in the Holy Ghost and have the Word of God. And a living example of that is the folks I just talked about earlier, Brother and Sister Young. I don't know if you've ever visited the church in Oakland or not, but I was always amazed every time I went to Oakland to preach or to be in service there, that this wonderful group of people was comprised probably, I don't know, 65% maybe, were all young people, most of them under 30 years old. And here's Brother and Sister Young, well past 50 years old, And they are leading these young people. And these young people don't know any better. They don't know that there's supposed to be a generation gap. They don't know that they're supposed to think that their pastor's older and therefore out of touch with their little fads and fashions of the day. And the reason they don't know that is that they are all in the Holy Ghost, where fads and fashions mean absolutely nothing. Praise God. And so, one generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts, so that nobody lives or acts independently of another. There is an anthropological progression of mankind in the church and in the people of God that has this ongoing connectivity. And of course, then the fact that we often mention if someone has died and all of our minds are on, okay, what happens after death and so forth, there is the fact that the church is a group of people of which Scripture says, wherefore we are encompassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, and that becomes the impetus, the reason that the writer gives to, therefore, let us run with patience the race that is set before us, because there is a crowd. And I don't fully understand what I'm about to say. I do understand part of it, but I'm sure not all of it. That also, the Bible says that those who have gone before us are made perfect by us. In other words, the completion of what earlier believers and earlier saints in the Old Testament, and earlier people of God, that their completion depended upon our arrival and upon the coming of the church age and upon the coming of the Holy Ghost. And so they were not perfect until they arrived here. And it is clear in the Bible that heaven is focused on this. This is why, you know, back in the days of a man named Ptolemy, or the Ptolemaic thinking was that the earth was the center of the universe and that everything revolved around the earth. And for hundreds of years, the earth was caught, all the thinkers on earth was caught in that paradigm, and they couldn't escape it. They were just caught in it. The other thing they were caught in is that all of the land that there is north of the equator. If you go below the equator, there's nothing but water. That was, for hundreds of years, that kept people from exploring. And this is what made Christopher Columbus and Sir Francis Drake and those people such great heroes in their day, is they broke the paradigm of fear and terror, which in all the maps of that day, and I've looked at those maps, in all the maps of that day, when you went out so far into the ocean, then the cartographer, the guy that drew the map, would say, from here forward is monsters. Because that's what they thought. And they had never gone out into that area. And people thought, the other thing they thought was it should fall off the edge of the earth. I have a picture in my office where two old ships are falling off the edge of the earth. And then there's a guy in a little motorboat, a little bitty motorboat, him and his buddy. And he's yelling to his buddy, I told you so. So, but they discovered that it wasn't like they thought they were, like they thought it was. And so, there is a way in which all of those old believers were not made complete unless we are here, which lets you know that there is this real connectivity. Now, I wonder how many people, Zachary was preaching about this tonight. Every once in a while, I wonder about things like that. They're probably preaching, here's three easy ways to quit fighting with your wife. But you know, or your husband, but you know, if you really get what I'm talking about tonight and you see the size of the connectivity that you and I are involved with, then it makes you recognize that it's not a good idea to fight with my wife. Number one, the angels are watching me. Number one, grandma may know what's going on, I'm not sure. But the main thing is that I am part of something big, and I am part of something that is bigger than the 70-year span of my life, or of this generation, or of this century. And it's not a figment of the imagination, it is a reality. And that in the church, we are being built together. The Apostle Paul said in Ephesians 2:20, he said, and we are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. So we are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Connectivity. We're 2,000 years later, but in what you and I are in, time doesn't have any meaning, or doesn't have much meaning, because in God's book, the Apostle Peter just preached Acts 2:38 just yesterday, or even in the first part of today, because scripturally speaking, the last days began with the church age, and we are still in the last days. And we say, oh my, that's 2,000 years later. But in the things of God, that God doesn't look at that as 2,000 years later. We are in the last, you and I would have to say, we are in the last of the last days. But these are the last days. We are in the last days along with Peter and Paul and James and John. We are in the last days along with the early church, all of us together. It's not like we are disconnected way out here. And then can you say amen?
Amen.
And then on top of all of that, the Bible makes it clear that, how could I say this? I want to get this across tonight. There is the fact that a person's influence on another can impact them over centuries. Like we use the Apostle Peter, he preached Acts 2:38. And then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. 39, for the promises unto you and your children and to all those that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Now, that's not all he preached that day, because the Bible goes ahead and says, and with many other words that he exhorted. So, but he preached that, okay? Then you and I came to an altar. We heard somebody preach that 2,000 years later, and then we came to an altar. But the experience, the dynamic experience that he promised, came into our lives absolutely equally fresh to what it was on the day that he preached it, and transformed us absolutely equally to what it transformed them, and did a miracle in our lives. I mean a miracle in our lives, in bringing us into the kingdom of God and making this scripture, which is my text tonight, come into being, which is that by one spirit are we all baptized into one body. And so we become together the body of Christ, because it is the Spirit of Jesus Christ that is in us. The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Jesus Christ, and it is in us. It's the Spirit of the resurrected Christ that is in us, and it is the new source of life. That's why Jesus said in heaven there won't be like flesh and blood like we know it, because on earth life is in the blood, but in heaven your body won't need blood, because life is in the Spirit. Because Jesus Christ, when he resurrected as a quickening spirit. He didn't have to pour new blood into us. He spilled his blood, and then his Spirit came, and our new heavenly body won't be powered by blood. It won't receive its life by blood. it will receive life by the Spirit that is in you, which is why you already have eternal life in you if you do not let the devil rob you of your walk with God. That eternal life is already in you. We've already received that. We've already got the earnest of our inheritance. This is why what we're doing is so critical. I can't let anything mess me up. I can't let anything turn me around. I can't let anything make me get discouraged. I can't let anything get me off the track. Oh, my Lord, that's crazy. Oh, what a God to give us a salvation like we possess tonight. My. On this Tuesday night, it's as good as it was on the day it was poured out at Pentecost. Let's praise Him again right now and thank Him for the Holy Ghost for salvation. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Amen. And so, there's much that can be said about all of this. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Connectivity from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to Joseph. 12 tribes on down. Through Moses, from Moses given to Joshua, from Elijah given to Elisha, from Jesus breathed on the apostles, and the apostles then preach it, and we get that Holy Ghost, which is the same Holy Ghost that anointed Moses to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt. It's the same Spirit, and that Spirit is here, and it's upon us. This is why the church can make it. You say, well, Brother Wilson, things could get so bad the church couldn't make it. I'm going to tell you, things cannot get so bad that the church can't make it.
Amen.
Now look, they could blow up this building. They could say we couldn't meet anymore. We'd have to figure out how to divide people into groups and hide in caves and all that, which has all been done throughout history. But this is just proof. Here we are 2,000 years later, and the church is growing faster than it ever did, and they've tried every conceivable thing they could to stop it. You don't have to worry about the church getting stopped. It's not going to get stopped. Amen. It may encounter a lot of different challenges, but God will turn all of them around to bring revival to hungry people. Amen. And so now here we are. It's our turn. It's our turn. Now, I'm 72 years old and have been preaching about 57 years or so. And during that time, I've seen a lot of things. But now at 72, there's things I know I didn't know at 52, which is things I didn't know at 32, which is things I didn't know at 12. Is that 20-year segments? You could use any, but it just gives you an example. And, however, there's things I could do at 32 that I could do at 52 that I can't do at 72. Okay? So what is the role? All the kids are at youth camp tonight. So what is you and our role? And you that are young, let's pretend you're a little older for just a moment. So what is our role in all of this? The Bible says, this scripture always intrigues me, that David served his generation. And he did it well. So it's safe to say, David served his generation well. Or you could say it like this, with the emphasis in a different place. David served his generation. So the implication is there. You and I can't serve much more than our own generation. So when you get a little further down the road, and a church even, when it gets a little more mature, then what is it supposed to do? It is supposed to set itself up to serve the upcoming generation, to bring them into strength and power and anointing, and help them to see and know and experience and carry on with the spiritual connectivity that you and I carried on from people that came before us that have set all of this up. And that's one of the things this church is doing tonight. This church is one of the sponsors of Camp West. This church puts money in these things. This church comes together and we get our kids together and send them to Camp West. And you parents making sure that they get there. And there's people there that are working together. All of them are older than the kids and they're all working together to see that that they're brought into an environment. Environments are created. You've got to have music. You've got to have worship. You've got to have people know what they're doing in the spirit. You've got to have preachers. You've got to have altar workers. You've got to have people that keep the dorm people. You've got to have people at the snack bar. You've got to have people at the cafeteria. You've got to have all of this stuff that's going on is part and parcel of what it takes with the infrastructure behind it to present the kind of environment that can continue the power of God sweeping from older to next generation and from them right on down the line. This has been going on, and this connection has been going on for not only centuries, but it has been going on for millenniums. And so this connectivity means, oftentimes I've thought of parents. Now, I don't have anybody in mind, so don't think I do. But I've thought of parents, and I thought, you know, that those parents would be better off if, this is in years gone by, if they brought their child, their little child, up here to meet me after every service. And if they told their little child, that's Brother Wilson. Brother Wilson is our pastor. And if they taught that child to love leadership and let Brother Wilson give you a hug, if they knew the value of kids touching people. And, I mean, maybe not every service, but you know what I mean. And then finding people. There's single mothers that I've told before. Said, look, find three or four, maybe more, women in this church that you make sure your little girl hooks up with them. Find three or four men with integrity that you make sure your little boy or your little girl, whatever it is, doesn't matter, that they know these pillars in the church and that they walk with it. And then make sure your little boy comes up here every week and that I get a chance to say, how you doing, bud? And there's a connection that is made there. Brother Young will tell you this is the truth. People who do not tie their children to the ministry and do not tie their children to strength within the church, if their kids are saved, the percentages are much lower than those that are. There are exceptions to that. There's exceptions to all of these kind of sociological data. But it makes a difference because there is a connectivity that doesn't have to do just with cousins and aunts and uncles or even just with touching. There is a connectivity, there is a touching, a spiritual touching that takes place. And when that spiritual touching takes place, I had a student who read the introduction to Ultimate Leadership, and he said, I noticed in there, he was writing a post to the students, and he said, I noticed in there that Brother Wilson said that he dedicated that book to Brother Verbal Beam, and that Brother Verbal Beam was one of the few men in history that he had met. Not many of these kind of men in any venue who takes on his own shoulders alone an entire people group or movement or even ethnicity or whatever the group may be. And under his own shoulders, he picks it up and transforms it and topples the strongholds that have held it from being what they were meant to be. And this man did that. And right now, if any of you are on the internet, do a little post, who is the spiritual hero in your life and all of that. And that all started with us introducing, but Brian Williams said we need to do this. And so I'm just a guinea pig that he uses to do it, the face to do it. And we took a little picture back here. We got Brother Bean on the wall and we put it out there because the student said the remarkable thing is that Brother Wilson never met Brother Bean. And he never preached in Brother Wilson's church. That he went to as a boy, but that there was a revival going on in another city, and his parents took him for a series of services that this man, Brother Bean, was holding in another service. And I was just a teenager, 14, 15 years old, and at the time he was an evangelist, he was 29 years old, he was single, and he spent most of his time praying and seeking God, and when he walked to the pulpit, it was an incredible just an incredible thing to behold, and the power of God and the move of God. I'd never been exposed to anything like that in my life. I had never seen anything like that, and it was like a parched ground that water came to, and it impacted me. There were no negatives like my parents saying on the way home negative things about the preacher. Later I found out there was negative things said about him, because it was controversial when you're in a place that's dead and you bring life. It's controversial when people's not used to life. And so all the dead people, they start griping about it. It's messing up the cemetery. But anyway, but the impact that was made from, spatially speaking, a distance. In other words, I wasn't his buddy. I did learn how to pray through the Holy Ghost, because when he would pray with people, I would get up at the altar and I'd get real close and act like I was praying, but I actually was listening to what he was saying to these people and sensing what the timing and the rhythm and the alignment with which he worked with people in the spirit and midwifing people that were being born and helping and assisting in those processes and finding out how all of that worked. But that kind of dynamic, this is why you don't want to be caught up in the trivial, shallow lack of understanding of people that treat church and God and spirituality and loyalty and faithfulness and all that casually. They treat it casually. You don't want to. That's a mistake, because there is deep and broad and staggering richness in this. Some of you, it took years to make the cycle to realize that, but I sense in my spirit that you realize that. And I mean, I'm not your daddy, but I'll just tell you, I'm proud as punch of some of you that have come through these kind of things, and come through negative stuff, and come through and all of that kind of stuff. And you've got to learn, you don't hate people when they're going through that. You're praying for them, you're working with them, you're not giving up, you're not going to let the devil have them. You're going to fight for them. And it takes wisdom, and it takes patience, and it takes frustration, and it takes keeping your mouth shut when you want to blow up, and it takes all those kind of things. It takes it with your children, it takes it with your marriage, it takes it with, but it's worth it, because there are spiritual dynamics that are working. There's a connectivity there that when it comes together, there's a fiber that's strong and powerful and rich, and it's going to get richer, it's going to get more powerful in you and in me. And the pathway of the just goes brighter and brighter into a perfect day. Amen. And we're together, and we're brothers, and we're sisters, and we're loyal to one another. And we don't have to be in each other's house every day. When we come to the house of God, there is a spiritual connectivity that immediately hooks up with each of us. And we know that. And so we know each other in a way that doesn't have to do with reading each of our biographies. Am I making a lick of sense tonight? That is a rich thing that you and I have. Come on, let's praise Him together right now. Oh, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Amen. So let me close here very quickly by saying everybody doesn't understand all of this. And there are some that almost no understanding of these things, and so they never quite get it. They never quite get it. They don't ever. I mean, first of all, you ought to appreciate any church that preaches the truth, stands for holiness and righteousness, and keeps the doors open, and maintains her integrity. I mean, anything that's righteous is better than nothing. And so we want to remember that. But that's the beginning. That's the base that we build on. So here's my challenge. How far can you and I, as individuals, go in understanding these things and letting God use us and become more powerful, and bringing righteousness to people, and bringing hope, and bringing the good news? How far can we as a congregation go in that? How far can we? I mean, you can't be flipping around. I mean, there was like somebody here Sunday. Okay, somebody I know. All right? They're heading into their fourth church in 2 years, maybe 2.5 years. Now, they live for God. They live right. They don't, sin. But they came to Pastor and said, the Holy Ghost has told me that I need to do this. Well, the only thing that the Holy Ghost was in that is that he was talking to Pastor instead of me. And that was the mercy of the Holy Ghost. Because I would have told him, you don't know enough about the Holy Ghost to get out of a cereal box. That's the truth. He's a good guy. I mean, I like him. But I mean, the evidence is the evidence. He'll be wandering around thinking he's some kind of preacher 5 years from now, still wandering around. I mean, you've got to get out of the business. There's people in this church, there's scores of people in this church that knows a whole lot more right here sitting on these pews right now about the Holy Ghost and how it works and the dynamics of the Holy Ghost than he does. He would be appalled if he heard me say that. I wish he was here. If he did hear me say that. If he's listening on the internet, I'm talking to you. Hallelujah. Amen. You need to learn to listen. You need to learn to shut up. All the little kids are gone to camp. And listen. And learn something. You don't know half of what you think you know. You're going to thank God I don't got them. Yes, you know, I know kids at home. I've never seen them. But you don't even know what you're doing. You're just pillar to post. And somebody says, oh, here's a glitzy little opportunity for you to scratch your itch. And oh, my God. And there's people in this church that never been in this pulpit in their life that are doing more for God by 10 than what they're doing. They're just running around scratching their itch all the time. I guess I'll be scratching their itch. There's a connectivity to this thing. There's a reality to this thing. There is a oneness to this thing. There is a body of Christ to this thing where we are together in this thing and we're working together. And there is a cumulative power in working together that you cannot duplicate by a bunch of little people out here popping off like firecrackers. All stand with me. Let's clap our hands. Let's pray with God together. Come on, let's love him a little bit. Amen. Let's thank him that we're in the body of Christ. Amen. Praise God. What are we going to sing? What? I need you to survive. I've never heard that one. I guess that's a Methodist song. Sing it. I don't know. I'm thankful for you guys. Wouldn't be in trouble if it wasn't for you guys. Sister Polly, you did so good tonight. In fact, this team up here, I mean, this team has done a great job tonight. I mean, this church is amazing. You can just pull anybody out and they can play anything up here. Some of these guys I haven't seen up here in 6 months. They're up here and you don't even know the difference, man. I mean, they just got it. I mean, I never could get it. Thank God for Jesus.
Oh,
it while they're singing it. 10. Would you do that? Go to at least 10 people and just say, I need you, I love you. I'm glad to be a part of the church with you. I'm with you.